physical, may go impossible. Why you have to scan your profile statement after harvest time? Well, there might be a reason, because one clock is more or less along the lines as well. We might go from beta wrong to exa wrong. Okay, so, and I also like to start with some quotes that I picked up during the course of days, and I hope I'm allowed to put them up here. So, we have seen a lot of talks about the keys. So we heard a lot about simulations in the realm of exascale computing. So I'm going to change gears now completely. I will not go to talk about simulations, but I will talk about the analysis of simulations. So, right, we might go to exascales with the simulations and produce petabytes or exabytes of data, but who's going to analyze that and how are we going to analyze that? And as I said already, are we actually capable of reliably analyzing these simulations these days, even the simulations that we have today? Okay, so simulations, and so therefore, let me give you, besides of those things mentioned here, another thing to worry about, which is the analysis. So this is the topic of my talk. I want to give you the state of the things of finding object structures in cosmological simulations. And as Franco did, I actually like to start immediately with my conclusions, so that you can go with me afterwards if you want. If you're not interested in the details, read this, conclusions, you can go to sleep now. So, we have 23 different codes that pretend, try to, manage to, find structures in these cosmological simulations of structure formation. They participated in a comparison project. And all the parts that I'm going to show you will basically prove that we have a 20% code-to-code scatter. Right? So whenever you talk about a Halo catalog from the simulations, right, if you give me another Halo finder, the same simulation, I might get 20% different results. Why is that? So I stay with the conclusions. So the reason basically is, and we spent, it took us a couple of years to figure this out, a number of workshops and several papers. The simple reason is that every Halo finder makes an intrinsic assumption about how to define a Halo. I'm not talking about how to define the edge of a Halo, I'm defining about the method that is underlying in the detection. So you can define the edge of a halo, the mass of a halo, the spin of a halo, in various different ways and get the scatter. We're not talking about that. We're really talking about the initial collection of particles that any of these codes thinks belong to an object. And they make intrinsic assumptions about that, leading to this kind of scatter. So it's absolutely unavoidable unless you go to a different code or which is a different method. So, the bottom line of all this is, this number, 20%, determines the accuracy to which we can trust the properties calculated. Mass, position, velocity, spin, shape, all that has an error of approximately 20%. So, welcome to the era of precision cosmology. Okay, so now, that was the conclusions, and now let me prove to you what I have just been saying. So, there is this Halo Finder comparison project which gained a lot of momentum in the past years, and I actually like to start with, it all originated right here where I'm standing right now, in 2008. So this is a shortcut, this is a cutout of the program from that conference, and you can see that I was given, I was asked by Ben to actually give a brief review about Halo finding techniques in cosmology. And that's when I started to think about these things, actually. And then, it grew. I mean, these are all the Halo finders that I plowed through the literature, starting with the seminal paper by Cosmological in 1974, where the first spherical overdensity method was mentioned. And these are all the Halo finders that I could find. There are certainly more than participating, so there are 37 methods mentioned here. And basically, the naive expectation is they should all give the same results. Do they really? So 23 of them participated when we called upon them. So we contacted every living person on this list here and asked them, would you be interested to participate in a comparison project? And 23 replied and said, yes, we do. So what did we do then? We started organizing workshops. So the first workshop took place in 2010 in Madrid, which is why it's called Humans Going Mad. Oh, this is another anecdotal story in the paper. When you look up the paper on Monte, you will find a little asterisk up here, because the referee, I hope the referee is not amongst the audience, requested me to resolve what mad actually means. See? Okay, I'll leave it at that for you to figure out why it's called Humans Going Mad. Then, 2 years later, we had the workshop Subhalos Going Nuts. Where did that take place? In Nottingham. All right. The first workshop was primarily focusing on field halos, so on large-scale structure simulations and isolated objects. Here, we used an Aquarius suite of simulations and focused only on subhalos. And just recently, we had the workshop Sussing Merger Trees, where we went now to the next stage of the analysis, where we compared tree bundles. So now we had a series of halo catalogs, one series of catalogs, and we applied different tree building methods on this one. I am not going to talk about this, I don't have the time for that, but I suggest you have a look at the paper. The paper has already been accepted and is on hpc-ch. Okay, so what are the outcomes of these workshops and the Halo Finder comparison project? I will briefly in a second give you a list of all the papers that came out, which is a tiresome list. So for those who don't want to read all the papers and follow the chronological order of how things happened, you can go to this review that Fraser and I have recently written and is in the press for monthly notices out there. It's a heavy review, it's 40 pages, but it basically contains everything that you ever wanted to know about halo finding, separating it into methods, definitions, precision cosmology, or log, and all these error estimates that I don't have time to go into very detail here. So you can see it is a huge international collaboration. It's orchestrated by Fraser and myself, and it has led not only to this review paper, but basically to a whole avalanche of papers, starting with the first one out of the first workshop. And then you can see subhalos. We focus on baryonic objects. We focus on not only on bound objects, but also on streams. We check spins, we check shapes. These ones in lighter color are in preparation or submitted at the moment. So shapes, clustering properties, one halo versus two halo terms. Then the merger tree, and we have lots of projects going on. And the plan is to also go to the next stage, which is semi-analytical modeling. And presently, trying to get the funds to organize the next workshop. So if you have 10K spare money, come and see Fraser. Okay, so what is the kind of data that we use for this comparison project? As I said, there has been halos going mad, there has been subhalos going mad, and there has been galaxies going mad. So for the first workshop, we used academic NFW Conquest Plumber profiles where we exactly knew what we put in. So we generated, with a given number of particles, a perfectly spherically symmetric object in the center of the box, or maybe not in the center of the box. And we also used the Barnostic simulation, which is a pattern of mega parsecs and the cosmological simulation. And I'm only going to show results for this, because for this, the results are actually boring. They are academic. This is the real thing. So, next workshop, we use the Aquarius simulation, and for galaxies going mad, so where we look for baryonic objects, we use one of the two simulations where we have the local group with Andromeda, Milky Way, and M31 at extremely high resolution in baryonic physics. So this is the kind of data set that we used. I also like to mention that everything is publicly available. The data, Aquarius, you need to ask us for the access, but you can download this. For this, I'm not sure if I put it up for everyone to download. Just ask us, you get the data. The halo catalogs are certainly all available. So if you don't trust the way I plot the results here, feel free to download the raw halo catalogs and make the plots yourself. Okay, so now let me step you through plots. Suppose halos going back, field halos in a large cosmological simulation. So, to actually try to avoid any ambiguities in halo definition, we ask all the participants, we ask them, please recall last defined variable situation. For those who have particle linking involved, like friends or friends, we ask them, please use this linking method. Then we further ask, please recall the peak value of this failure, the circular rotation curve. So that's what we ask them. Use this definition, use this linking, or use this linking length, and return this number. Okay, and now we have two plots. We have this plot, which is the cumulative mass function, as a function of mass, and we use 200 critical as the definition for mass. And if you look at it like this, then you might say, okay, everything is hunky-dory, you don't need to worry about everything, they all agree. But the people at different scales here is we have different resolutions for this. 1,000 cube particles, 5 cube particles, 256 cube particles, because not all participating codes were capable of analyzing 512 cube particles. Exascale. Okay, so if you look at it like this, everything's fine. But look at the residuals. Look at the residuals. So these are 10%. This is 10% by 10% one. There is quite some scattering. How long are you time wise? This is a different question. Yes, this is a different question. Okay, we don't ask the question which is the right code, which is the wrong code, which is a good code, which is a bad code. All these codes are being used for public scientific scientific publications. All of them are being used. Okay. 15 minutes. Okay. So I might actually add a little bit upon this. This is not a new result. We would have not needed to run this comparison project to know this result. Why not? Go through the literature and check all these analytical fitting functions to mass function derived from cosmological simulations. I did not do that, but the PhD student of a very good friend of mine did it. So if we go to this website, it's a student of Chris Power. So if we go to this website, the student, it's embarrassing to have the name of the student. Chris Power is the driving force behind this. Okay, so here you can. It's basically every single analytical fitting function to mass function, starting with press shifter, which is not a fitting function, but then check formal, you see if you're Warren, Reed, Colton, Tinker, Colton, Eagle, all of them have been coded up with Python, and you can say, please plot this for me. Unfortunately, not the residuals, but if you look carefully, this is what I have done, you can see exactly this scatter here. Why is that? Because these fitting functions are based upon different halo finders. This is the scatter that we see in these analytical functions. Play it again. That comes on top of it. Yes, so it is convolved with different simulations. So arrows from simulations also propagate into this. No, they don't. But anyway, this is not the source of the problem, because here we ask them, so every code here was asked, please, use 200 rule critical. I come to this in a second, because in the second workshop, we did not trust the code developers anymore to use the same definition. So we outsourced the calculation of the mass. But that's the next thing we learned. So let me bring up another plot, which is the VMAX function. So this is now the peak of the rotation curve, and it's the cumulative number of objects above a given VMAX, and you basically see an even larger scatter. Okay, bottom line. So halos going back, focus on field halos, the properties are affected by the choice of the halo finder. There is scatter. So let's move on to subhalos going north. So now, as I said, we wanted to outsource as much as possible. So we did not ask them for calculating any properties anymore. We just asked them, give us the particle ID lists of those particles that you think belong to an object. And then we used a common post-processing pipeline to calculate whatever we wanted to calculate. We even removed a duplication of particles. So for instance, the host halo might contain the particles of the subhalo. We eliminated all of that. So we only allowed a particle to belong to one object. We calculated the mass ourselves. So if we screw it up, we screw it up for everyone in exactly the same way. So now you expect, right, the scatter should reduce. It doesn't. It doesn't. You still see the same kind of scatter. This is now the subhalo mass function. This is the subhalo relax function. Maybe the scatter is a little bit larger, so now it's more within the 10% bounds here, and before it was in the upper bounds, but that comes back to Nick's question. These are also, I need to be very careful what I'm saying here, because people are in the audience who participated. It is a more challenging task to find subhalos, so those codes that are able to find subhalos need to be developed more. Okay. I hope people understand what I'm trying to say here. That might have reduced a little bit of the scatter. But nevertheless, the subhalo properties are also affected. There is still scatter. Okay, last thing, baryonic objects. So if we go to include all these messy gastrophysics, baryonic physics, what will happen now? Okay, this is again subhalo. Subhalos of Milky Way, Andromeda, and M33, subhalo mass function. Unfortunately, we don't have the residual response, but it doesn't matter because this is not the message that I want to get across here. So, relax function, again, scatter. What I like to get across, this is the beautiful picture that shows the variance. See? Alright? So, these subhalos contain variance. And this is one particular subhalo, which is the best example. So, what I have done to produce this plot is I went into the simulation, this is the upper panel here. And to the position where I know there is an object, and I more or less know what is the size of this object. I just went into the simulation and grabbed every particle within a sphere, and I color-coded the particles. So blue is gas, red is star, and black is dark matter. All right, and this is the simulation. This is basically a poor man's visualization of the simulation. And now, what do the halo finders think belongs to this object? Yeah, you can see. One thinks there is no gas in it. Another one also thinks there is no gas in it. Another one thinks, hey, there is a spherical distribution of gas in it. Another finder thinks, no, only on one side of this object I have a lot of gas. Alright, so for the gas, it is even far messier than for the dark matter only. Okay. Bottom line here, gas properties of your objects in the simulation are heavily affected by the choice of your halo finder. No, if you pick this halo finder, you will find gas in your halo. If you pick this halo finder, you will not find gas in your halo. There are some stars here. This stuff here, this medium size is stars. The dark matter we actually don't see because I decreased the symbol size. So what you see here, this is dark. So they agree on that, it's collisionless. It's collisionless. But gas has additional properties. It has a temperature. Do we take that into account when we unbind or not? Do we take that into account when we unbind? Maybe here, maybe not there. I don't know. It is messy. It is messier than we initially thought. Okay, so coming back again to the conclusions, there is 20% code-to-code scatter. You cannot avoid that. But we look even further. So as I said, for subhalos going knots and for galaxies going mad, we outsourced the calculation of all properties. But what we did not outsource was the gravitational unbinding routine, for instance. So for this overview paper, so you've seen it before, for this review paper, we did a lot of more tests also, outsourcing, unbinding, outsourcing this, doing that. And basically, the only thing that we did not outsource initially the particles. That was the only thing we didn't know about stars. And whatever we did, we ended up with more or less the same kind of scatter. So our conclusion is, it is intrinsically encoded into the halo finder what a halo actually means. You have phase space finders, they have got phase space, so they have a different understanding of what a halo is. Two friends of friends who just link particles that are close by. This method itself, this difference introduces the scatter. So now, again, you might ask the question, which is the right one? Let me just finish with saying, I'm also a player in this game, so I have my own halo finder, and this is a publicly open source, open API, API-parameterized halo finder. It supports all your favorite simulation formats. It is one of the fastest, and we also did timing tests, so if you're interested in the timing, go to this review paper, you'll find a table in the appendix that lists you the timing. It's one of the fastest, we have the best friendly user support you can imagine. Your US community. Okay, so much for the question, which is why did you pick? But what about exascale computing? I should have actually prepared, I think, one or two slides about exascale computing, but remember again this Madrid simulation where we had different resolutions. 256 cube, 512 cube, 1024 cube particles. And there were only a handful, like 2, 3, 4 finders able to analyze the 1024 cube. All the others, they gave up. Some gave up at 256 cube, some gave up after 512 cube. We are very, very far from exascale computing when it comes to dealing with the petabytes of data that your simulation.